Hello, and welcome to a new episode of Constructing Kingdoms with the Violet Howler, a literary analysis of the Kingdom Hearts story. In celebration of the franchise's 20th anniversary, I wanted to talk about a plot motif that I've seen many fans over the years try to fit into their analysis and predictions for the future of the series. A common trope in many narratives, particularly coming-of-age ones, involves a character who believes themselves to be relatively mundane and ordinary by the standards of their environment, only to discover at some point that this was a lie. That all along they were never normal to begin with, and have always been something special. In fantasy and science fiction examples, the character often learns that they're at least partially a completely different species, or the lost heir to a royal bloodline, or even both. The exact details and circumstances vary from one story to the next, but it's common for characters who fit into this trope to feel out of place in the relatively mundane environment they grew up in. Many of them have difficulty interacting and bonding with other people for one reason or another, only having a small number of people they're truly close with. But many of them know, or at least suspect, that there's something different about them, and they often yearn to one day find a place where they fit in. Among the Kingdom Hearts fandom, a theory I've seen circulated many times over the years is that this trope will eventually come into play with Sora himself. That at some point in a future title, we're going to learn that there's a special cosmic destiny that explains why he, specifically, is the one who will open the door to the light. Why his heart in particular is capable of achieving seemingly impossible feats that we rarely, if ever, see other characters pull off. And it's not very hard to see why people get that impression, given the number of details that emphasize the importance of Sora and his Keyblade over others. Throughout the first four games in the series, despite knowing that other Keyblade wielders existed, the organization consistently treated Sora like he was the single most important one. Both the Keyblade of Darkness that Mickey found and used to help seal the door to darkness, as well as Xehanort's recreation of the original Keyblade that can unlock access to the Heart of All Worlds, are specifically modeled after the design of Sora's Keyblade, the Kingdom Key. And there are some stealthy parallels between Sora and King Arthur in the original game that frame the Kingdom Key as a parallel to Excalibur, the sword which symbolizes Arthur's right to the throne of Britain. When all of this is combined with his crown necklace and the throne imagery associated with him in official art over the years, it's no wonder that some fans think Sora is destined to essentially be the king of Kingdom Hearts. But there are two crucial details that I don't recall ever seeing anyone who argues for this theory acknowledge. One is that series creator Tetsuya Nomura has been consistently telling people over the last 20 years that Sora is just an ordinary boy with nothing special about him. Given that consistency, I find it unlikely that Nomura would suddenly reveal that he outright lied, or that his insistence on Sora being ordinary was a case of using exact words to obscure future spoilers while technically being truthful. But the other detail that theories about Sora being the master of Kingdom Hearts overlook is that the Kingdom Key that people are convinced represents this destiny originally belonged to Riku, who, like other examples of this character archetype, has been depicted feeling out of place and unsatisfied in the ordinary world he grew up with, longing and eager for something more. And who we've seen in previous titles having difficulty connecting and interacting with other people outside of a few close friends. All of which contrasts with Sora, who makes friends easily and isn't in a rush to leave his ordinary life on the islands behind, even as he wants to explore other worlds. And unlike how he denies Sora being special in any way, Nomura has dropped hints in older interviews that Riku is something more than a regular human. In the Chain of Memories Ultimania, the series creator describes Riku's arc in the game being about his relationship to the darkness, and concludes by saying that some things, like what he is, have yet to be explained. This references how Naminé and Zexion both make comments indicating that the way Riku is able to control his darkness is something unique to him, suggesting that the things he's able to do are so rare that other examples are unheard of, or are not supposed to be possible within the laws of how their universe works. Young Xehanort implies a similar sentiment in Dream Drop Distance when he expresses that Riku somehow found a way to trap darkness inside his heart without suffering any of the usual side effects. But Riku's ability to achieve feats that are rare or impossible is not limited to just his command over darkness. Because like his darkness, Riku's light is shown to be on a completely different level compared to anyone else in the setting so far. From what we've seen with Ventus in Birth by Sleep and the new Seven Princesses in Kingdom Hearts 3, a heart of pure light is not something any person in the KH universe is ever born with. But despite never having had a heart of pure light as far as we know, Birth by Sleep shows us that Riku's inner light was so powerful that his heart acted as a beacon, drawing at least two separate Keyblade wielders to Destiny Islands. Think about that for a second. Keyblade wielders and other interworld travelers need to be standing directly in front of a Princess of Heart in order to sense their pure light. Yet at just 5 years old, Riku's non-pure light was so powerful that it was visible from orbit! And that doesn't even scratch the surface of what Riku's light is capable of. 0.2 uses timing and visual context clues to heavily imply that the light which came out of the door to darkness and destroyed Xehanort's Heartless when Sora declared that Kingdom Hearts is light actually came from Riku's heart. In Kingdom Hearts 1, Sora connects the story that Kairi's grandmother tells about how there is always a light even in the deepest darkness with how Kairi was able to save him when he was turned into a Heartless, and uses her saving him to justify how he knows that he'll be able to save Riku. Shortly after this, the final mix release adds a long-distance conversation in the Realm of Darkness between Mickey and Riku, where the King says that he already has the Keyblade for the Dark World. Yet according to 0.2, he literally only just obtained that Keyblade less than a minute before the big Kingdom Hearts is Light moment. When Mickey and Aqua are nearly blinded by that burst of light from Kingdom Hearts, clips of Riku from that exact scene from Kingdom Hearts Final Mix are shown on the screen before the light fades and Mickey spots Riku running toward the Door to Darkness. And since light is canonically generated by the connections between people's hearts, one likely interpretation is that the moment Riku imagines Sora running toward him in response to Mickey asking if he can feel the echoes of his friend's hearts represented Riku realizing that Sora's heart was still reaching out to him, causing the light in his own heart to shine out from within the Door to Darkness right as Sora declared that he knew what Kingdom Hearts really was. So Riku's light is not only powerful beyond even those whose hearts are completely devoid of darkness, but his light is directly tied to the heart of all worlds, implying that Riku is some sort of avatar of Kingdom Hearts. Which makes a lot of sense when you consider the role that his virtual doppelganger fills within the Datascape. Because Data Riku was specifically chosen by Data Nominate out of every other resident in the Datascape to serve as a vessel for all the memories contained within Jiminy's journal when it was digitized. And we know from previous games that in Kingdom Hearts lore, memories are at least partially stored in the heart. All of the information in the journal based on the events of Kingdom Hearts 1 takes the form of recreations of all the worlds that Sora and team have been to, much like how the inside of Sora's heart takes the form of Destiny Islands in Dream Drop Distance. So by being a container for the journal's memories, you could say that Data Riku is the heart of all worlds within the Datascape. And this potential parallel between Riku and his digital counterpart further adds to the connection that Kingdom Hearts 3 and its DLC draw between himself and Yozora. Similar to how Data Riku, as the journal's avatar, has abilities connected to Data, Yozora displays Data-related abilities during his boss fight in the secret episode, like I mentioned 5 months ago in my Constructing Kingdoms video, The Ferryman, about his role in the narrative. And as a psychopomp figure, Yozora is responsible for guiding Sora into, and most likely out of, the metaphorical underworld of Quadratum for the descent on the heroine's journey, much like how Data Riku can transport people into and out of the Datascape. Meanwhile, in Kingdom Hearts 3, the logo animation for the final world matches the path of Riku's footsteps during his sacrifice just moments prior, implicitly drawing a connection between Riku and a place inhabited by the hearts of fallen people that have yet to fully leave the world of the living. And the DLC shows Yozora, who explicitly resembles Riku, being able to manipulate that space by first transforming it into Sora's heart station before changing their surroundings to Quadratum. Another thing worth pointing out is that in Kingdom Hearts 1, the Door to Darkness that Xehanort's Heartless used in order to try and access Kingdom Hearts is located in a place where the hearts of fallen worlds gather. The first area of which greatly resembles a corrupted version of the place where the hearts of fallen people gather. And the only time Sora sees this location is after Riku had lost his body and his heart was cast into the Realm of Darkness, just like the true Kingdom Hearts was said to have been after the first Keyblade War. So if there is going to be a true king of Kingdom Hearts, all of these details are pointing to the eventual reveal that it's been Riku all along. That all the imagery associating Sora with royalty was the result of Riku symbolically giving up his cosmic throne. And Chain of Memories indirectly implies that this was not an unexpected consequence of his fall to darkness, but rather was a deliberate choice made long before the first game even started. Sora's fake memory of Naminé that is given the most significance in that game's story involves a promise of protection made under a meteor shower, followed by the exchange of a good luck charm that one of the people in the memory had had since they were born. Naminé's descriptions of her own powers in various games and novels indicate that she can only make new memories by stringing together pieces of existing memories, and that she cannot fabricate new memories out of things that the person had not already experienced. Meaning that while Naminé's presence in the memory was fake, the core details of that memory were based on a real one. And the fact that the Riku replica otherwise has all of the real Riku's memories indicates that the other person in the real version of Sora's memory of the meteor shower promise was Riku. Because by Naminé's own admission, it is not possible for her to give both Sora and the replica the same fake memory unless a real version of the memory exists in Sora and Riku's hearts. And it's even more obvious that the real promise was between Riku and Sora when you pay attention to the pronouns in the original Japanese script. Because after being made to remember the promise, Sora immediately starts referring to Naminé using the same rough, masculine-leaning pronoun that he's been using for Riku after an entire game of only referring to her using appropriate feminine pronouns. On top of all that, the novel also describes the good luck charm being worn around the recipient's neck in its depiction of the replica's version of the memory, and out of himself and Riku, Sora in the present day is the only one that wears anything around his neck. The shape of which just so happens to fit inside the teeth of the Keyblade that was originally supposed to be Riku's. Developer interviews in the Kingdom Hearts 1 Ultimania have even confirmed that the idea of Sora receiving a charm from Riku that looks exactly like the necklace he wears in the finished version of the game, that becomes the keychain for a Keyblade whose Japanese name means passing memories, was something they came up with very early in the development of the series. So even if he's not yet aware of the significance, Riku basically already gave his crown to the boy he loves years before Sora took the Kingdom Key from him. Which carries some fascinating implications for how the reveal of Riku's true nature will affect the ending of the story. Because in the context of what the necklace symbolizes, there are two potential meanings that can be interpreted from Riku giving away his crown charm to Sora. The first possibility is that by the end of the series, Riku will have severed his connection to Kingdom Hearts and fully given up his role as its avatar slash ruler. This would fit with how Nomura indicated in the Recoded Ultimania that Data Riku's memories were no longer protected from being erased by his status as the Journal's avatar once the datascape had been completely debugged by the end of the game. It also has precedent when you consider the endings to some of the Disney stories whose main characters he has parallels with. The Little Mermaid ends with Ariel, the mermaid princess who I've discussed in previous episodes having parallels to Riku, becoming human full-time instead of only during a 3-day window so that she and Eric can be together. In the Kingdom Hearts 3 novel, Riku is directly compared with Rapunzel, who loses her magic healing powers after Eugene cuts her hair in order to break Gothel's hold over her, which freed her to pursue the life she wanted and removed the last obstacle to their relationship after she manages to use the last of her powers to save him from dying. Meanwhile, at the end of his original movie, Hercules regains the godhood and immortality that he lost when he was stolen away from his birth parents as a baby, only to give it up so he can stay on Earth with Megara because his life would be empty without her. And I've repeatedly mentioned in multiple previous videos how Kingdom Hearts 2 and 3 draw parallels between Herc's relationship with Meg and Riku's relationship with Sora. But the other possible way to interpret what Riku symbolically giving away his crown represents is that Sora will become the same type of being, essentially ruling Kingdom Hearts at Riku's side. This would be supported by the fact that Sora is referred to on multiple occasions as the one who will open the door to the light, implicitly setting up that he will one day open the door to the true Kingdom Hearts that was lost after the first Keyblade War. Which Master Xehanort states in his report from Birth by Sleep will cause whoever opens it to become something far greater than human. Not only that, but the door Xehanort's Heartless used in Kingdom Hearts 1 to try and access the Heart of All Worlds explicitly required two people in order to close. And the original Keyblade that's supposed to be able to open access to Kingdom Hearts is designed in a way that indicates it's meant to be wielded by two people working together, like Sora and Riku's combined Keyblade in Dream Drop Distance and Kingdom Hearts 3. Kingdom Hearts 2 also provides some Disney parallels that could potentially serve as foreshadowing for Sora's possible ascension. At the end of his second visit to the Land of Dragons, Mulan asks the Emperor to give Shang a vacation so that the two of them can spend time together. When her request is denied due to Shang's responsibilities as the Emperor's bodyguard, Mulan is instead offered a job working alongside Shang so that she can still have what she really wants. And like I discussed in my previous video, seeing this happy ending makes Sora cry because they remind him of himself and Riku. Earlier, in Sora's first visit to the Pride Lands, he suddenly and inexplicably expresses a desire to become king after agreeing to help Nala overthrow Scar. Meanwhile, Simba, the rightful heir to the throne, has multiple parallels with Riku that I discussed in my earlier episode on microcosm to macrocosm foreshadowing. Either possibility would work as an ending to Sora and Riku's journey because both options resolve the divide that the reveal of Riku's nature would otherwise create between them. Many fictional relationships where one character is some kind of supernatural entity frequently involve that character either being completely immortal or having such a long lifespan that they still outlive their partner by a considerable length of time. While it's unclear at this point whether Riku's connection to Kingdom Hearts comes with immortality, that connection is something that still needs to be addressed before the narrative reaches its conclusion. Because in heroine's journey narratives that feature an animus figure, like I've explained Riku is for Sora, the formula is supposed to end with the protagonist and their animus as equals. Which can't really happen in Kingdom Hearts if we have Sora stay as a regular human while Riku turns out to be something equivalent to a god. Meaning that before the series is over, this gap has to be bridged. Either with one descending so that both are human, or one ascending so that both are gods. Given how the repeated imagery of Sora reaching out to try and grab Riku's outstretched hand implies a build-up to the moment where Sora finally succeeds, I feel that there's a higher chance the series will take the path of Sora ascending to basically rule the universe at Riku's side. But there's nothing that conclusively rules out Riku fully giving up his cosmic role and becoming a regular human so that he and Sora can have a relatively normal life together, so it could still go in either direction. I honestly don't have a preference one way or the other, but I want to know what you all think. Feel free to share your thoughts in the comments and sound off on which potential ending you think would fit best with the series' themes. Thank you all so much for watching. After I load this episode, I'm going to be taking a hiatus from new videos for at least the next 6 months. I've been working almost exclusively on these videos for the last 8 months to the point where a lot of my other projects have fallen by the wayside. So I'm taking a break to give myself time to recharge and give those other projects the attention they deserve. I don't know if my hiatus will be longer than 6 months, but either way, I'll post an update video on July 31st for the anniversary of my first episode to give you all an idea of where I'm at and how much longer I expect the hiatus to last. And if you're watching this video after my hiatus has ended, then check the description of this video for a link to my next one. If I'm still on hiatus when you're watching this video, be sure to subscribe so you can be notified next time I upload, and I'll see you back here again in a few months.